The Diamond Sutra, Ordinariness, the Characteristic of a Buddha. Ordinariness is the characteristic, it is his essence. Ordinariness is a unique quality, that is the essence or the insignia of a Buddha. Ordinariness is his extraordinary. To be ordinary is the most extraordinary as well as difficult thing in the world. Generally, it is considered to be extraordinary is difficult, but indeed, the other is the way. It is very difficult. After attaining to awakening, you are aware of everything and yet still remain ordinary. There is no pretense. You are leading the life of the most ordinary. There is something very beautiful about Saint Francis. He was awakened a Buddha. Saint Francis of Assisi lay on his deathbed, was singing, and singing so loudly that the whole neighborhood was aware and had gathered by the window of his house. Elias was pompous but prominent member of the Franciscan order. He came close to Saint Francis and said, "Father, there are people standing in the street outside the window. Many had come, fearing that the last moment of the life of Saint Francis had come. Many who loved him had gathered around the house." Elias said, "I am afraid nothing we might do could prevent them from hearing you singing. It might lower the esteem in which you yourself are so justly held. Perhaps in your extremity you have lost sight of your oblivion to the many that have come to regard you as a saint. Would it be more edifying for them if you would die with more Christian dignity? If you would die with more Christian dignity." "Please excuse me, brother," exclaimed Saint Francis and said, "but I feel so much joy in my heart that I really cannot help myself. I must continue to sing. I must continue to sing." And Saint Francis continued singing. And he died singing. In the whole Christian history, it is only Saint Francis who died singing. Many Zen masters have died singing, but they do not belong to Christianity. He is the only Zen master among Christian saints. He did not care a bit about Christian dignity. Now what happened? Elias wanted to prove to the people that Saint Francis is a saint. Now he is afraid that people will think that he is not a saint. Instead, they may think he is mad or something else. A saint has to be sad. By the very Christian definition, Christians believe only in sad saints. They cannot believe that Jesus ever laughed. That is below Christian dignity. Laughter is so human and ordinary that it cannot be the quality of a saint. They know only one thing: to put Jesus there high above the humanity, and for this all that is human has to be taken away out of him. Then he becomes just a dead, bloodless. Elias is worried. This is the last moment. Francis is dying, and he will leave a bad name behind him as far as Christian tradition and dignity is concerned. People will think either he was not a saint or he was mad. Elias is worried because he wants to prove. In fact, he is not worried about Saint Francis at all. Instead, he is worried about himself and the Saint Franciscan order. Accordingly, it will be very embarrassing for us later on. How are we going to answer these people? Also, what happened in the last moments? Definitely, Elias is worried about himself. If the master is mad, then what about the disciple? He is a disciple. These represent two different planes of consciousness, two different dimensions together. Elias is concerned with public opinion. He wants to prove his master to be the greatest one and to be the greatest of the saints. He knows only one way to prove it, that he should be serious. Take life seriously and should not laugh or sing or dance. There should be no celebration. Celebration through singing or dancing. They are too human. They are too ordinary. Ordinary mortals can be forgiven, but not a man of the stature of Saint Francis, that he is singing and dancing like ordinary people. But Saint Francis was of a different vision. He had different consciousness. He is just ordinary. He says, "Excuse me, please, brother, but I feel so much joy in my heart that I really cannot help myself. Inner serenity and joy is overflowing as song. Inner serenity and joy is overflowing as song, and I must." And Saint Francis continued singing. In fact, it is not Francis is singing. Instead, Francis has become song. His whole being is pulsating, overflowing with song. And that is why he cannot help. He has no control over it. There is nobody left in him to control and sustain. He has become a flute. The moment flute is ready, it is hollow inside, and when through the opening the air is blown, it echoes as the music. The song is happening simultaneously. The song is happening spontaneously. It is not within its control, because the controller has disappeared. The self, the ego, does not exist in you anymore. Saint Francis does not exist as an individual. There is absolute silence within. His existence as a drop has vanished. The drop has dissolved in the vastness of the ocean. Now, instead of drop, there is ocean. The moment drop dissolves in the ocean, the individuality, all that relates as finite, vanishes. The self, the ego, the memory, all that is the quality of an individual vanishes, and instead there is an oceanic presence, an absolute silence inside, and out of that silence the song is emerging. I am speaking to you, but there is no one to speak. The words are happening. It is the inner silence. It is the inner harmony. It is oneness that is assuming the form of the words. Just as when you speak, the words are of an analog format, it is the device through which the words are spoken, converts it into digital format. I am speaking, it is analog. The system of Skype converts it into these words into digital format. It is the digital format that travels. And when this message, this sound, this silence reaches your system, that converts the digital format back into the analog format, and you can hear it. The self, the ego, no more exists. Saint Francis does not exist as an individual anymore. There is absolute silence within. And out of that silence, the song is emerging. What can Francis do? That is why he says, I cannot help it, I must sing. And Saint Francis died singing. Indeed, there can be no better death than entering the existence singing and dancing. If you can die singing, full of total awareness, that proves that you lived singing and your life was a joy, and death became the crescendo of it, the culmination of that joy that you have experienced in your life and lived that joy. Saint Francis is a Buddha. The ordinariness is the characteristic of Buddha that he is. He signifies that he has no idea about himself or how he should be. He is simply spontaneous and allows whatsoever overflows in the precise moment actually happens. He lives on the spur of the moment, and that is his authenticity. Indeed, that is his authenticity. He is simply spontaneous, available to the moment, and whatsoever overflows in the precise moment actually happens. He lives in the spur of the moment, and that is his authenticity. You can call this his characteristic, but what kind of characteristic is this? It is simply that he has no characteristic at all. There is no preconceived idea how would he behave in a particular circumstance or situation. It is simply that he has no character, no armor. He does not live from the past. He does not know of what Christian dignity is. He lives in the moment like a child. He lives in the moment like a child. And that is the beauty of Saint Francis, living like a child. Buddha says, yes, Subhuti, for Tathagat has taught that the dhams special to Buddhas are just not Buddha's special dhams. That is why they are called the dhams special to Buddhas. This ordinariness is his extraordinariness. Nobodiness is his somebodiness. Absence is his presence, and death is his life. He does not live from the past. He does not know anything of Christian dignity. He lives in the moment. He lives in the moment like a child as it comes. Whatsoever comes, he lives with that. This is his unique quality. The Lord said, what do you think, Subhuti? Does it occur to the stream winner? By me has the fruits of a stream winner been attained? Subhuti replies, no indeed, O Lord. And why? Because, O Lord, he has not won any dham. Therefore he is called a stream winner. No sight object has been won. Any sound, smell, taste, touch, or objects of mind. That is why he is called a stream winner. If, O Lord, it would occur to a Buddha, to a stream winner, by me has a stream winner's fruit been attained. Subhuti has attained the fruits of a stream winner. Then that would be in him, seizing on a self, seizing on a being, seizing on a soul, and seizing on a person. Buddha spoke of four stages of a seeker. Four stages of the seeker. Let us understand this. The first he calls the stream winner. A stream winner means one who has entered into the Buddha field, one who has become an initiate, or who has become a sannyasi, who has entered the fold of Buddhahood. His journey has begun. He has been part of the stream that is constantly flowing, the stream of awakening, the stream of Buddhahood flows around Buddha, and you have entered into that stream. He is called the stream winner because he is no more standing on the shore. Up to now he was standing on the shore, thinking whether to enter the stream or not, whether to enter the main free or not. Now he is no more static. He has started moving with the stream of life. He is no more fighting with the river. The ego that used to fight with the river, and that ego that used to go upstream, is no longer there. Ego always likes to go against the flow of the stream. Feels flowing with the stream, there is no effort on his part. This is an ordinary phenomenon, and he wants to prove that he is extraordinary. He wants to prove that he is extraordinary. So he wants to go against the flow of the stream. Now again you will feel it is absurd. The stream has won. That is why he is called a stream winner. He has dropped all conflict. He has surrendered. That is why he has become victorious. And that is why he is called a stream winner. Indeed, these are strange words. First, he was trying to win the stream. This is what everyone is doing in the world. People are trying to have life according to their own criteria, according to their own desires, plans and projections. All are trying to impose a pattern of their own making, dreams and desires upon life. Everybody is trying to go upstream. This entails a struggle. Everybody is trying to fight with life, nature and with God. The ordinary human life is the life of conflict, guided by ignorance and ego. Man has forgotten with whom is he fighting. You are fighting with your own source. The fight is with you. And the fight is going to lead you into deep anguish and frustrations, because you cannot win. That is not the way to win. You think that you are winning, but you will be defeated, because you are only a small, very insignificant, tiny part. And existence is vast. It is enormous. You cannot win against it. You can only win when you are flowing with existence, with the stream. You cannot win against it. However, you can win only through it. If it supports you, you can win. If it does not, you can go on believing that you will be defeated ultimately. It is only a matter of time. Sooner or later you will be tired, frustrated, exhausted, by the fight, and then you will drop, but then you drop out of defeat. And in that defeat there is no joy. How can there be joy in defeat? The people of understanding know that before defeat comes, if you can surrender, there will be joy. The people of understanding know that before defeat comes, you can surrender and there will be tremendous joy. Surrender and defeat are so different and yet so alive. The defeated also seems to be surrendered, and surrender seems to be defeated, but there is difference that is just apparent. Only on the surface the two look seen. Deep down, two worlds are different. The defeated feels angry, in rage, in frustration. He is in deep anguish. The one who has surrendered has no misery. He is elated and ecstatic. He has understood that the whole fight was meaningless and was destined to fail. It is as if your left hand starts fighting with the right hand, or it is your fingers fighting with the body. How can they win? It is destined to be doomed. The man of understanding surrenders. He said, "Let God be. Let thy will be done. Let thy kingdom come." He says, "I am no more. Flow through me. Let me be just a hollow bamboo, a reed flute. Sing through me if you wish so. Sing through me if you wish so." The flute, the bamboo reed, is hollow inside. He says, "I am no more. Flow through me. I am just a bamboo flute, a reed flute. Sing through me if you wish so. If you do not, let silence pass through me." He becomes just a passage. He starts moving with the stream. He allows the life's stream take possession of him. In that state, fight ceases, and even swimming. He floats effortlessly and moves with the wind. To enter into such an understanding with life is called becoming a stream winner. This is a Buddhist, the stream winner. Buddha continues, to enter into such an understanding with life is called becoming a stream winner. This is the first stage of the disciple. The word is strange. Surrender is called winning because fighting leads to failure and defeat, and surrender leads to ultimate victory. And when there is victory, there is a joy, there is blissfulness, and a different kind of a life journey begins. This life is paradoxical. What can Buddha do if life is a paradox? What can Buddha do if life is a paradox? Those who have surrendered prove themselves to be the winners, and those who go on fighting one day finds they have lost all their energy in fight, and there is no sign of any victory anywhere. Alexander had failed but not Saint Francis. Napoleon has failed but not Jesus. Genghis Khan and Tamerlan have failed but not Buddha. Their real history should not be bothered about failures. But history is concerned with all those who have failed. Genghis Khan, Tamerlan, the Alexanders, the Napoleons. The real history should think more of Buddhas, Jesus and Francis. These are the real people who have won, but their winning evolved out of their surrender. They won because they surrendered. Just think of the beauty and benediction of it. When you are not fighting, you are just going down the river with it. It takes you to the ocean. That is the destination. It is going to the ocean. You are unnecessarily making much fuss about it. It is going already. You simply go with it and you will reach to the ocean, the ultimate, the infinite. This utter surrender to exist, Buddha calls the fruits of stream winner. Then comes the second stage in the disciplehood. It is once returner. He returns once. And this third stage is never returner. He never returns. And the fourth is called Arhat, the stream winner. He forsakes all three fetters. That of a stream winner, that of once returner, and lastly that of never returner. The first stage is that of ego, individuality, the idea of a separate self. This is the state of a stream winner, when an individual comes in the company of the master, he considers himself separate from the whole. Naturally, this is the root cause of all fight, misery and despondency. Second is living by mere rules and rituals. There are so many religious people, but they live only by rules and rituals. They know nothing of religion. Ritual is not religion. Rule is not religion. Religion is a totally different kind of life. It is a life of awareness, life of love, life of compassion. But if you look around the world, you will see millions of people going to the churches, to the temples, to the mosques, to gurdwaras and all their places of worship. They are praying, doing this and that. It is all rituals. The religiousness does not exist. It is missing. Only empty rituals are being followed. I have heard. Once a man was doing the Shraddh ceremony in the honor of his just departed father. Shraddh means a ceremony that is performed for the dead. It is a ceremony performed during a certain period of time in the year. His father has just passed away. Shraddha is a ceremony performed when somebody's father or mother dies. It is a kind of a prayer for the journey of the departed ones. A prayer is being performed that will help the departed one to continue his descent. It's like a satellite is launched and it is being monitored. to reach to its destination. It is on a long voyage. Shraddha is a prayer for the journey of the departed one. During the ceremony, the family dog wandered into the prayer room. Afraid of defiling the occasion, the host hesitatingly got up and tied his dog to a post outside in the designated area. Time flowed on. Years went by. When he died, his son started performing the same prayer ceremony in the honor of his father. He was anxious to follow it to every detail. He remembered the dog ritual. So he had to catch hold of a dog from the neighborhood. As he thought, tying the dog to a post formed the part of the ritual and formed the part of the prayer. As he thought, this was an important aspect during the entire prayer. The man remembered it must be very important. That is why my father had to get up in the middle of the prayer to do this honor of tying the dog outside. Tying the dog outside. And when he had tied the dog to the post, then he became so happy and thus prayer continued. So tying the dog and returning to the prayer place happily is considered as part of the prayer, and he was not going to miss anything as the ceremony has to be perfect. By this time it happened that the family had no more dog, so he has to run into the neighborhood to find a stray dog. He got hold of the one, tied it carefully to the post in the covered area, the porch, and then he returned to the prayer to finish the ceremony with a satisfied conscience. In that family down the centuries, the rule is still followed. In fact, the sacred dog ritual has become the most important aspect of the whole ceremony. This is how things move. People go on living unconsciously. People go on living unconsciously. Your father were doing something. Their fathers and their fathers were doing the same thing. It takes on the aura of sacredness. You just go on repeating it religiously as a ritual without understanding the meaning of it. Jesus called God my Father, Abba. You go on calling your Father, but it is meaningless. You do not have the same heart or feeling or understanding as Jesus had when he addressed God as Abba or Father. Then calling God as Father is a mere ritual, the superficial. You do not have the heart that has called God Abba. The word Abba is not meaningful. Instead, the feeling in the heart that Jesus has for God. If that feeling is there, there is no need even to say that word. Feeling will do. But in the absence of the feeling, it is a mere ritual. I have heard. One winter night, after the four-year-old girl was tucked comfortably in her bed, under the comforter, the mother reminded her for the prayer. Unwilling, the girl sat with folded hands in supplication and began the prayer. But when he realized the mistake and she started saying her table prayers, realizing what she has done, she looked upward with a big smile and said, "Father, it is that prayer. Delete it. Erase that prayer, Jesus." Realizing that Jesus might have not heard this time, the girl loudly repeated, "Delete that prayer as I have made the mistake. Now I have to begin the prayer all over again with the correct one." Then she proceeded with her bedtime prayer. Rituals are like that. The girl was in her innocence, but this is what she has learned as a tradition. How innocently said Jesus, "Please erase that prayer I had said, the table prayer instead of the bedtime prayer." Rituals are like that. They never grow in you. Instead, they are just imposed upon you from outside. You go on repeating these rituals mechanically. Buddha says that a few things have to be dropped by stream winner. First is ego. Second is living by mere rules and rituals. Third is doubt and perplexity. Human mind is never relaxed. It is a doubting mind and cannot surrender. A doubting mind can never be total. Doubting mind means one part is there, the other is absent. One part is fighting against the other. One goes on denying. The doubting mind cannot see an absolute yes. And that is the fundamental of becoming a stream winner. You were a seeker up to now. With initiation, you have entered into the stream and you say yes to life. You say yes to life. To say the unconditional yes, to say yes simply with your whole being is indeed enough. And the solemn prayer. If you can simply sit silently and can say yes to existence, this is enough. Nothing more is needed, no ritual. First, these three things have to be dropped by the stream winner. Then the second stage is called once returner. Once returner means one who will die and come back one more time. He can only come one more time after this. There is no more coming and going. The process is coming to an end. The third stage is never returner. One who will never come back again. Yes. To forsake lust for life, lust for the other life, lust to be. And the fourth stage is called the stage of Arhat. The stage of Arhat one who is absent and nobody, nothingness, he has become a Buddha. Buddha called Subhuti about these four. He asks, does it occur to the stream winner by me? Has the fruits of a stream winner been attained? A simple question, yet very significant one. Subhuti replied, no indeed, O Lord. And why? Because, O Lord, he has not won anything. If you say, I have surrendered, then you have not surrendered. Because how can you surrender? You have to be surrendered. The ego has to be surrendered. Then you cannot say, because there is no one. No one to say that I have surrendered. The very purpose, the very essence of surrender is you have attained to emptiness within. If it is something of your doing, then it is not surrender. People go on inquiring how one can surrender. And I say, no, you cannot. You are the barrier in the process of surrender. You just get out of the way and surrender is complete. Surrender is not something that has to be done or can be done. It is not a doing. Surrender is an understanding. Surrender is an understanding. There is no more fighting mood. I is always in a fighting mood. I can never be without fight. It exists through the fight and survives through fight as well. The very existence of I depends on fight. Either you will be fighting with others, or if you change that direction, then you will start fighting with yourself. This is what your monks are doing. This is what is happening in your temples and churches all around. And what is the outcome? Now they start fighting with themselves. The body says, I am hungry. And they say, no. Now this is fight. Now ego has arisen in a new way, this subtle. Ego says, look, I control my body so beautifully. I am the master and body is the slave. Your eyes are tired and they say, we want to go to sleep. And you deny them the sleep, saying, no, I have decided to stay awake the whole night. This is my meditation. I am on a particular meditation. I cannot sleep. And if you feel good, now this is fighting. Your body wants a little comfort, but you continue to sleep on the stones. Your body needs a small shelter and you want to stand in the hot sun or the rain. Your body wants a few clothes and you stand naked in the cold. These are the ways of fight. These are the ways of fighting. Now you do not have the world to fight with. This is true. So you have divided yourself into two. Ego lives through friction. Any kind of friction will do. So ego goes on creating many frictions within, many fictions within. The husband fights with wife and wife fights with husband. These are nothing but ways of feeding the ego. The more you fight, the more ego asserts itself and becomes strong, and greatest strength the ego gets is from fighting with you. Because that is the hardest fight. To kill somebody else is one thing, not so difficult. The only difficulty is that it is legally condemned crime. However, to kill you slowly, continuously for many years is a difficult job. It is a slow suicide. The ego feels very good. There is no legal punishment for this, and even if there is, then who is to be punished? Once you are gone, the matter subsides. That is why the so-called religious monks have great egos. If you want to see how they are, go to the Himalayan mountain or in the caves or in the monasteries and you will find them there. A man who has surrendered cannot claim that I have surrendered. He can only say surrender has happened. A Buddha cannot say that I am enlightened. All he can say that enlightenment surrounds me. Enlightenment surrounds. No, indeed, O Lord. And why? Because, O Lord, he has not won any dhamma, therefore he is called a stream winner. Because you have dropped this very presence that has been creating an obstacle, that is why you have called us surrendered. You cannot claim in any way that I have surrendered. If you claim that you have surrendered, you have missed the whole point. No sight object has been won. No sounds, smell, tastes, touchables, or objects of the mind. That is why he is called a stream winner. He has not won anything like an object. In fact, rather than winning anything, he has dropped the very idea of winning. That is why he is called a stream winner. He has dropped the whole fight that was going for many, many lives. He has dropped the whole project now. He is no longer interested in it. He has not won anything visible. Rather than winning anything visible, his ego sense has vanished now. But in that losing of the ego sense, great victory happens. And that victory is such that cannot be claimed by the awakened one. If, O Lord, it would occur to a stream winner, by me, has a stream winner's root has been attained, then that would be in him self-seizing on a being, seizing on a soul, seizing on a person. The moment you think I have won, I have surrendered, again you have created a new I. Once again a self has arisen and you have started the subtle ways of the ego. Again you have perceived the self. The English word perception is beautiful. It comes from per, cap or capio, meaning to take hold of, to seize, to grasp and to capture. The moment you perceive that you are there in any way, you have captured again the ego and ego has captured you, but this time it is in a very subtle way. Again you are back in the old game. The whole point is lost, then you are no more. The whole point is lost, then you are no more a stream winner. This way Buddha asks about once returner and never return. However, the two are indeed the same as a result. I have taken it into the sutra. And finally, the Lord asked, What do you think, Subhati? Does it then occur to the Arhat? By me has Arhatship been attained? Subhati, no, indeed, no, Lord. Subhati, no, indeed, O Lord. And why? Because no dham is called Arhat, and that is why it is called Arhat. Simply once you get the idea is that you have started moving into the world of truth, you cannot be a claimer. Your claim will actually become disclaim. Once a man asked Buddha, have you attained? And Buddha responded, I cannot claim because I have attained. Just see the beauty of it. He says, I cannot claim because I have attained. If I claim, that will surely be a sign I have not attained. But see the difficulty too. And if Buddha says, I have not attained, then this is a lie. If he says, I have attained, that is not possible because there is no I in that attainment. That attainment is such that it happens only when I has disappeared. You see the difficulty. Difficulty that language creates. Buddha asks, what do you think, Subhuti? Does it then occur to the Arhat? By me has Arhatship been attained? Remember, Arhatship is not a state. It is not something like an object that you can catch hold of or possess it or hold it. It is utter freedom. Not a thing to be possessed. Instead, Arhatship is a state of freedom. You simply go on dropping your chains. One day when all chains have disappeared, and now even the last chain of I-ness has disappeared, then there is nobody present, and that consciousness, when nobody is present, there is absolute emptiness within, is Arhat. Buddha asks, does this occur to Arhat? I have gained Arhatship. That is why he is called Arhat, because he is aware that he has not gained anything. And why I am, O Lord, the one whom the Tathagat has pointed out as the foremost of those who dwell in peace. Now Subhati takes his example and he says, you have declared of me that I have attained. You have declared of me that I have become an Arhat. You have declared that I now dwell in peace. This is a special way of Buddha saying that there is nobody inside. This is dwelling in peace. Dwelling in peace means there is nobody, because if there is somebody, peace cannot be possible. And if there is somebody, turmoil will continue to be the ways and means. The house is silent. Only when there is nobody in the house, even if one is there, a little bit turmoil will continue. Even if one person is there, he will put things from here to there. He will do something. Even if he is fast asleep, he will snore. Something is bound to happen. When there is nobody at all, then there is peace. And Buddha calls this state, when there is no one, there is utter peace, the state of Arhat. Then there is absolute peace, so much that there is not anybody to be found there or anywhere. The ocean that was the source of waves and roaring has become tranquil. Buddha says, now Subhati, you dwell in peace. One day I rose like one of the waves on the surface of the ocean. One day I rose on the surface of the ocean like one of the waves. This is how the journey begins. You rise as one of the waves on the surface of the ocean. And then one day, the wave dissolves. Mit aaj chala saagar ki gehrai mein. Today I have drowned in the vastness of the ocean. First, because of the interaction between life, as a wave you come onto the surface of the ocean, then wave dissolves in the vastness of the ocean. And after wave dissolves in the vastness of the ocean, what remains? Regaye khamoshi si har mauj. In every turmoil, in every vicissitude, there is silence now. In every circumstance, in every situation, there is silence now. Then what is the ultimate then? Tufano ko jaise sahil mil gaya aur reh guzar mein. It appears as if every turmoil, every vicissitude has found a shore. When the surface of the ocean is so vast that there is no end to it, seen in closeness, the bird has to fly and fly endlessly to find a shelter to rest for a while. The storms have subsided. There is tranquility within. Zindagi ke samandar mein utha tha ek din lehron sa. One day I rose on the surface of the ocean like one of the myriad waves. This is how everybody comes into existence. Mit aaj chala saagar ki gehrai mein. As the process continues, surrender has happened. I have entered into the stream of inward journey. Mit aaj chala saagar ki gehrai mein. Today I drowned in the vastness of the ocean. And when you drown in the vastness of the ocean, reh gayi khamoshi si har mauj mein. In every circumstance and situation, there is tranquility, there is peace, there is serenity, there is harmony, there is oneness. Buddha calls this state as the state of arhathood. Buddha says, now Subhati, you dwell in peace. Reh gayi khamoshi si har mauj mein. Tufano ko jaise sahil mil gaya har reh guzar mein. Tufan means turmoil. A great storm, a great hurricane that happens in our life again and again. It appears as if every turmoil, every hurricane has found a shore. Buddha in fact is saying now, Subhati, you are no more. Both are same, Subhati says. You have declared that Subhati dwells in peace. You have declared that Subhati has become an arhat. And you must be true, Lord. How can you be untrue? And I cannot say it does not occur to me. An arhat is I, and free from greed. If that occurs to me, then you are wrong. If it occurs to me then that I am an arhat, then ego has arisen. Then the self is seized, then again I am caught in the ego trap in a subtle way. If it arises in me that I dwell in peace, then the peace is lost because I has entered once again. The dweller is back. Then you cannot dwell in peace. When peace is there, there is no one to say that I am at peace. So Buddha hesitates in saying that I have attained. It surrounds. I have not attained anything. In fact, I have lost everything. Then you cannot dwell in peace, and then something is bound to happen. A misery, a dream, a desire, and the world, the whole new world starts. Ego is the seed of the world. The small seed contains the whole tree in its womb. Just feel I am. nourish and nurture it, and the whole world comes flowing immediately. The whole world comes following immediately. When one has disappeared, when the dweller is no more, then peace is attained. Nothingness is the taste of Buddha's message and his being too. One has come home when only absence prevails, but then nobody can claim, then nobody can come and say or brag about it. To understand Buddha, you need a new glimpse of non-being. Just linguistically, you cannot understand what he is saying, but that will not help much or take you far into it. You will have to have a few glimpses of it, and they are possible. Sometimes, just sitting silently, doing nothing, keep quiet. Not even a mantra to disturb you, not even the name of God, not even a special yoga posture to sit in, or even to contemplate, or even to meditate. Just sitting silently in your room, or by the side of the tree, or by the side of the river, or lying on the grass, or looking at the stars with closed eyes. Something tremendously beautiful happens. Just being there, overflowing the surge of energy, going nowhere, the glimpses will start coming to you. For a moment you will feel you are and you are not. You are utterly you are, and yet still you are not. You are not, and for the first time you are. Then you will see why Buddha is so paradoxical, why Diamond Sutra is so conflicting and difficult to understand. You are only when you are not, when all is absent, when all that is finite is absent, then there is a great presence. When ego has completely disappeared, you are the whole, you are all. You disappear as the drop and you become the ocean. On one side you have disappeared, and on another side you have appeared, and for the first time. Enlightenment is death and resurrection both simultaneously, and they both happen simultaneously. Here happens death, and immediately it is followed by resurrection. This is the meaning of Jesus on the cross. He died as a human and born as the Son of God. When Jesus is on the cross, he was accepting a miracle to happen. The Father or the angels will come. They will remove him from the cross. The humanness in Jesus complains, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" A peace, a silence, a serenity descends. And an ecstatic Jesus says, "Let thy will prevail. All pain and suffering is gone." Jesus is enlightened. And in Christianity, this is represented by the word resurrection, but you will have to taste or savor it. These words are not mere words. These are not just doctrines or philosophies. Instead, these are existential experiences. But I understand your difficulty. Many questions arise and I am flooded with these questions. When talks on Sufis is there, your hearts dance. But this talk on Diamond Sutra and your heart is not dancing, this is higher. This is more rarefied, difficult to understand. Sufism you can understand. They are close to you, close to heart. They talk about love. At least you have heard about the word love. You have some ideas what love is. You may not have understood the love Sufis speak of. However, at least you know something about love. You know at least what is love. You have been hearing about love. Your heart starts melting. But these words of Buddha are far more superior. But it is not so with everybody. A few questions have arisen. All are thrilled. It depends. Still there may be someone whose heart still begins to dance. So much with the Diamond Sutra as if he may almost is having a heart attack. When I am speaking, it is for so many people now. And for those who will come to the fold later on, they are different. Their approaches are different. Sometimes it will fit with you, while at other times it may not. When it does not fit, you have to be patient. When it does not fit you at this moment, you have to be patient. Is still, because when it fits with you, it will not fit with somebody else. You have to keep patience. I am speaking for the entire cosmos, and not only I am speaking with you, for you, I am also speaking for millions who are not here yet, to whom these words will reach. Sometimes, if you feel that Diamond Sutra is too difficult for you or unapproachable for you, be patient. Listen to it again and again. Maybe your heart is still not dancing. Maybe it is higher or deeper than the heart. Maybe you are not yet ready. There are things of the head and there are things of the heart. There are still things which are beyond both head and heart. There are things which are beyond both head and heart. Diamond Sutra is of the beyond. Beyond head and beyond heart. And the beyond is very difficult. You know something of the head and you know something of the heart. But you know nothing of that which surpasses the boundaries of the head and heart both. But these words are rare. This Diamond Sutra is a diamond, the most valuable diamond that ever exists in the world of spirituality. No one has spoken in so many minute details or has taken such flights. But if you feel that you cannot fly so high, never close yourself. Make effort and continue. Even if you can go a little further, then you can go right now. Even if you can take a few steps towards the unknown, that will enrich you tremendously. These words will sink deep within, and then one day many blooms will appear as the inner soil continues to be nourished by the compassion of Buddhas. All of a sudden, not only your heart, instead your whole being will start dancing to an unknown melody emanating from a distance first, and then will come close to you and assimilate within you. First it will appear far, then it will come slowly and slowly, closer and closer, and is still closer to you and assimilate within you. In the barren soils of thy inner sanctum, in the barren soils of thy inner sanctum, oft do I use the manure of compassion. Then one day seed of awakening I sow. Then one day seed of awakening I sow. With the rain of thy infinite bliss, with the rain of thy infinite bliss, this seed shall sprout one day. Indeed, the seed then will sprout one day. And then what will happen? And then reckoning shall reap the fruits at the dawn of new awakening. And then reckoning shall reap the fruits at the dawn of new awakening. And then what will happen? A very simple, long, prolonged happens. It can go on. Oh, like a deja vu it happens. Like a deja vu.